And today we start our seminar with a talk by Sergii Torba about a new method for recovering the Sturm-Liouville problem from the Weyl function. So please.
Okay, thank you very much. Please let me share. Okay. So can you see me? The presentation?
Yes.
Yes, we can see the presentation.
Okay, perfect. As I have written in the invitation letter, it is a talk based on a joint paper with Vladislav Kravchenko, which we recently uploaded to archive. So if you will have some additional questions or want to look for more details, please look for that paper. I will post the reference at the end of the talk. So first of all, I would like to briefly present you what is the Weyl function and why we are interested in recovering the Sturm-Liouville problem, the potential and boundary data from this function. So the main idea will be to show that a lot of different inverse problems can be easily transformed into the same inverse problem involving the Weyl function given in a countable set of points. So let us begin with some definitions. Okay, we are considering the following Sturm-Liouville equation in the Schrödinger form. Here Q is a real valid potential. For this talk, it can be any L2 function. And everything is defined on a finite segment. And for definiteness, we assume that it's from 0 to pi. Lambda here is the complex spectral parameter. And we consider boundary conditions. So at the point 0, it is a boundary condition involving a small h parameter, lower h parameter, and at the point pi, it is another similar boundary condition, but involving capital H as a parameter. And together with these boundary conditions, we consider the following boundary value problem. So the only difference is now is that now at the left end point, we are saying that the combination of derivative and the solution should be equal to 1. Okay, so what can we say? If lambda, which in some places we will consider the square root of lambda and we are denoting it by rho, if lambda is not an eigenvalue, meaning that the problem 1, 2 does not have non-trivial solutions, in such case, the problem 1, 3 possesses unique solution. And we can denote such solution by capital phi and parameterize it by this rho and x, the independent variable. Okay, so in such case, the value of such solution in the point 0 is called the Weyl function of the problem. And the solution phi itself is called the Weyl solution. So, just roughly speaking, what is the meaning of the Weyl function, if you think about it in such case, suppose that we want to solve the problem on the computer or by any other means, this boundary value problem. Everybody of us knows how to solve cache problems. For that, we have a huge library of software, etc. But to have a cache problem, we need to have the value of the function and the value of the derivative. So, what is going on if you think about this particular boundary value problem? The value function says us how do we need to complement the Cauchy data, because this condition in the left-hand point together with the value of the function in point zero will give us complete Cauchy data. Look, we have the value of solution at zero. It is exactly our Weyl function. And the value of derivative can be calculated from this condition three. So in some sense, the meaning of the value function is that if you want to solve some boundary value problem, how can we complement the necessary cache data? Or some other persons are speaking about Dirichlet-Neumann map, etc. Everything of that kind are closely related. So, like, once again, the Weyl function is saying to us how to complement the Cauchy data to be able to solve the boundary value problem. Okay, but also maybe some of us have seen another definition of Weyl or Weyl-Titchmarsh function, given not by such expression, but given by the fraction of the derivative and the function at one point. And now I will explain that indeed there is another definition, but they are equivalent. So, the previous definition is from the book of Yurko, Introduction to the Theory of Inverse Spectral Problems. And many results, which I will cite during this talk, are also from this problem, from this book. So if I'm not presenting some reference and saying that such result is known, okay, you can go to this book and consult it. But as I was saying, there is another common definition of the M function, which is also called in some articles Weyl-Titchmarsh function. So you can refer to the article by Barry Simon, A New Approach to Inverse Spectral Theory, first part, Fundamental for Formalism. And in such case, what is done is that one considers a particular solution of the equation satisfying such Cauchy data at the right endpoint. You can see this Cauchy data and compare and just see that it is a solution satisfying the secondary boundary condition. And in such case, having such solution, the Weyl-Titchmarsh M function is defined as follows. It's the fraction of the derivative at zero and the solution at zero, the values. Okay, as I was saying, actually, the two definitions are equivalent, and so the such simple relation holds that the Weyl-Titchmarsh function is just the parameter h plus one over the value of the Weyl function. So in many problems which I will speak about, for some theoretical constructions and everything, I will work with the capital M function, but for some particular examples, I will present the value of the small m function, and without saying anything, it's clear that without any problem, we can obtain the second one. Okay. So, Another representation of the Weyl function and some connection of it with some particular spectral problems. Consider now another two solutions of the Sturm-Liouville equation. One solution is given by the following Cauchy data. So it is one at zero, and the derivative is small h at zero. As you can see, it is a solution satisfying the first boundary condition. And a second solution, the solution S, is defined as following. It is zero at zero, and its derivative is equal to one. So it is a second linearly independent solution. It is easy to check. And now let us denote the following the two functions, delta of lambda, which is phi prime plus capital H multiplied by phi, and delta zero, it is S prime plus capital H multiplied by S. So what is the meaning of these functions? First function is exactly the characteristic function of the spectral problem 1, 2. Okay, so if you have some eigenvalue, this eigenvalue will be zero of this function and vice versa. And the second function is also a characteristic function, but if you change the first boundary condition by the Dirichlet one. So at the second, at the right end point, it is the same boundary condition. And at the left end point, we are saying that the solution is equal to zero. And the eigenvalues of such a spectral problem coincides with the set of zeros of this function. Then, the Weyl solution can be expressed in the following form. It is the sum of the solution S plus the Weyl function multiplied by solution phi. And the Weyl function is given to minus fraction of the two characteristic functions. So immediately from this expression, we can see some properties of the Weyl function. First of all, both these characteristic functions, delta and delta zero, are entire functions of the variable lambda, because the solutions are entire functions. And so the Weyl function is a meromorphic function. It is a fraction of two entire functions. Its zeros coincides with the mixed spectrum, where one condition is Dirichlet and a second condition is this our mixed boundary condition, and its poles coincides with the first spectrum. Okay, so it is the properties of the Weyl function which we have. It is meromorphic. We know the set of its zeros and they are simple. We know the set of its poles. They are also simple, etc. And also we can present another representation of the Weyl function. So if we denote the spectra of the first the spectrum of the first spectral problem by lambda n, the corresponding eigenfunctions will be the functions phi of rho n x. And consider additionally the sequence of Norman constants. So the squares of the integrals of the squares of the eigenfunctions. I recall that for such Sturm-Liouville problems, having a small and capital H as real numbers, the spectrum is consists of real numbers. So corresponding eigenfunctions are also real valued, and for that reason we don't have to put absolute value or anything. So here we have the square of real valued function. And having such set of Norman constants, the following representation holds for the Weyl function. It is the infinite sum of 1 divided by alpha n and divided by lambda minus the spectral value lambda. So in principle, if one has the spectral density function, which in such case the set of lambda n, the numbers lambda n, and the set of corresponding Norman constants, one can calculate the Weyl function for any lambda. In some sense, it is a reduction of this classical inverse problem to the problem involving the values of Weyl function. So now I can formulate the first inverse problem, which will not be a topic of this talk, but which is quite natural in the theory of inverse problems, because a huge number of some generalization like inverse problems for graphs, for higher order equations, etc., etc., are formulated in the terms of corresponding Weyl functions of or Weyl matrix valued functions or something like. So the problem is that given the Weyl function m of lambda, find a real valued potential q and the constants small h and capital H such that this function m will be the Weyl function of the problem 1 and 2. Okay, so here I'm not speaking about the conditions on function f m, so that the problem is solvable, etc. It's not so easy to formulate as for classical problems, because it involves that, okay, the function should be a fraction of two entire functions with some asymptotics, with some distribution of zeros. Okay, so let's say it's more complicated, but at least what is well known, starting from the first papers of Marchenko, is that if such problem is solvable, its solution is unique. And actually, a solution of this problem can be reduced to the classical inverse problem for Sturm-Liouville equation. The reduction is based on this representation. So we have the meromorphic function. And what we have to do is to find all poles of this function. Such representation states us that the poles of this function coincides with the numbers lambda n, and no more poles exist. So finding all the poles, we have the spectra, and finding the corresponding residuals at these poles by such known formula from complex analysis, we find the corresponding Norman constants. So if you have the Weyl function given on the whole complex plane, we are done. We look for poles, we look for residuals, and we reduce the problem to classical inverse problem. But as you can see, to perform such process, okay, it's one possibility to solve it. And second possibility is to take the set of all poles and to take the set of all zeros of Weyl function. That will give us two spectra and the classical theorem by Levitan, if I'm not mistaken, states that it is sufficient, or by Borg and Marchenko, it states that it is sufficient to have this data to recover the potential and boundary data. So hence the Weyl function on the whole complex plane, there is some theoretical procedure which gives us a result. But I will show you that normally we don't have such information about the Weyl function. So if you consider some particular problem, we will arrive only at the problem that we know the values of the Weyl function in a count. And so here we face the following problem. If this countable set of points has a finite limit point, okay, you can say that, but we can apply the general theory of functions of complex variable, and if an analytic function is defined in a set of points having limit points, it is uniquely defined on the whole complex plane, and more or less in principle we are done, but such construction is non-practical, because if we an analytic continuation of a function, especially if you think about that we don't have the countable set of points, we only have some finite subset, is a task which is not practical. So I will present a different way to look at this problem. And first of all, I will show, but before that, I will show some examples where you will see how naturally the Weyl function appears and only in some set of points. So first, consider the two spectra inverse problem. In such case, we have two set of boundary conditions. The first, which we have already considered, and the second, which I was saying you that it is the Dirichlet boundary condition at zero and a mixed one in the point P. The spectra of the first problem we will denote by lambda n. The spectrum of the second problem we will denote by nu n. And the inverse problem consists in recovering potential and boundary parameters from given two spectra, the set of the sequence of lambda n and the sequence of the numbers nu n. So, returning to the definition of the Weyl function, we immediately can check that the function m at the point lambda n is equal to infinity, and the function m at the point nu n is equal to zero. So look, we know the values of the Weyl function in a countable set of points, which is a union of these two sets. And we don't know anything more about this function. And we know that in principle, it is all the information which we need to solve the problem. Okay, so next example, like some generalization of the previous one. Suppose now that we don't have two spectra, but we have three spectra. Okay, there is a theory which is saying that to have three complete spectra is too much. More or less, we need like two thirds of each spectra to be able to recover potential. Or we can consider the, so here I am providing the reference to the paper of Gestesi, DeLeo and Simon, inverse spectral analysis with partial information on the potential. Third part, updating boundary conditions, where such problem is considered, and the conditions on how much, what is the number of eigenvalues we have take from each spectra for the problem to be uniquely solvable. Also, we can consider the inverse problem where like one half of four spectra is given. So here I am referring to the paper by Pivovarchik. Or we also can consider a problem where some parts from n spectra are given. And there is also an article by Horvath where such problem is considered. And generally speaking, all these problems can be formulated as follows. we have the sequence, two sequences. One is a sequence of numbers lambda and tilde, and a second sequence is a sequence of numbers hn, and they are given such that lambda n tilde is some eigenvalue of the spectral problem having such boundary condition. So at the right endpoint, it is the same boundary condition as before, but in the left endpoint, it is some different boundary condition involving the constant hn. And that's all. So here, such formulation includes all the problems which I mentioned and some more general problems. And the problem here is to recover the potential Q, okay, together with this constant capital H. The constants small h are given, as I was mentioned before. So how this problem can be transformed to the problem for the Weyl function? It's very simple, because this first condition can be written down in the following form. As the Weyl-Titchmarsh M function in this point lambda n tilde is given to the fraction of the derivative of solution over solution. So it is exactly hn. So you can see that again we arrived to the problem where the Weyl-Titchmarsh function is given in some countable set of points. Okay, so next problem, which is called the Hochstadt-Lieberman inverse problem. It is known as follows. So we are given one spectrum of our initial problem, and the potential Q is known on the half of the segment. It is known from 0 to pi over 2. And the problem is to recover the potential, together with and the problem is to recover the potential on the whole segment. So here again we can even assume that there are some generalization of these problems where the potential is given only on some part of the segment. For example, if the potential is given from 0 to 3 pi over 4, then one needs only half of the spectra, etc. So you can consult the work of Gerstasy and Simon for precise conditioning. But what is interested for us is the following. So suppose that we have an eigenvalue lambda n tilde of this problem, and suppose that the corresponding boundary constant is hn, h small n, and it is known. In such case, we may consider the following Cauchy problem. So we are looking for the solution which is 1 at point 0, and its derivative is hn at point 0. You can see that exactly at point lambda n, this condition satisfies first boundary condition, which means that it is an eigenfunction. It automatically satisfies also the second boundary condition. But now we are facing the Cauchy problem, and we know the potential on the half of segment, which means that we can solve the Cauchy problem up to the point p over 2. And we know the value of this particular solution at the point pi over 2. So we have the values v of at pi over 2 and v prime at pi over 2. So we may consider the function m, which is the fraction, but I have put here the parameter pi over 2, meaning that this function is corresponding to the Weyl-Titchmarsh function, but defined only on the segment from pi over 2 to pi for a half segment. But everything is known here. And again, you can see that we arrive to the problem that the Weyl-Titchmarsh function is known. Its values can be calculated easily, but only in some countable set of points. So here we have seen some known inverse problems, which reduces easily to the following problem. So we are given the values mn of the Weyl function in some set of points zeta n, such that mn can be arbitrarily complex numbers or the value infinity. And the problem is to find the real valued potential q and the constants h small and capital H, real valued such that the Weyl function of the problem 1, 2 takes the prescribed values at the prescribed points. Okay. Now the situation, and also if you return to all previous problems, you see that the set of these points zeta n is the set of points going to infinity without any accumulation point, without any finite accumulation point. So we cannot apply easily the theory of complex variables or functions of complex variables to be able to reconstruct the function m. And to show that this situation is not so easy, I just want to mention the following case, that such problem may not be uniquely solvable for some set of points. Just think about if you take only points zeta n equal to points lambda n to one spectrum. In such case, we know that the Weyl-Titchmarsh function is equal to infinity at each of these points, but we know that one spectrum is not enough to recover the potential. We can take arbitrary and find some asymptotics, and it will give us different potential. So you can see that even if the even if such inverse problem possesses a solution, it may not be unique. So we may ask a question: okay, can we say something at least about the set of points zeta n? So that the solution of the problem is indeed unique, and the answer is yes. Such problem is completely solved, but not so long ago. So the first result, which is from the paper of Gestesi, Del Rio, and Simon from 1997. Gives a sufficient condition. And now we are, the condition by Gestesi, Del Rio, and Simon says that the points zeta n, okay, we are assuming that they are real, shouldn't be too far to the right from the points n squared over 4. So this operation is zero if the point, if the difference is less than zero, and it is a value of this difference if it is more than zero. So if the point, so here probably I need to say that this number should be increasing. So zeta n be a sequence of distinct increasing positive numbers. But now if the numbers zeta n are not too far to the right from the numbers n squared over 4, so that such sum is convergent, then the problem is uniquely solvable. If you have two Weyl-Titchmarsh functions given coinciding in this set of points zeta n, then they coincide for all complex plane, and the corresponding potentials and boundary parameters are equal. A complete characterization of the set zeta n can be consulted in the paper of Horvat of 2005. I don't want to enter into more details. Okay. At least such condition is more or less practical, and you can check that if you have a set of points zeta n obtained by taking the union of two spectra, then indeed it satisfies such condition. But it is very close to the limit case. If you take points, if you take the same two spectra and remove just one point, then the condition will fail. Okay, so for that question, we have some answer already, but if you ask about the algorithm, it's not so simple. The algorithm of solution is given by some infinite products and analytic continuation. And here I would like to show you one quote by William Randall, a person having a lot of experience in numerical methods, and stating that it is one of the guiding principles of computational analysis that such proofs often lead to elegant mathematics but are useless as far as constructive methods are concerned. And it is what can be applied for this problem. So if you look for the demonstration from the paper of Del Rio, Gestesi, and Simon, you cannot take it to the computer if you are provided only with some finite set of points. We need something different, and that is the topic of this talk. But first of all, I will show you some motivating examples how the method which we developed work for some potentials. So for first, we take a nice potential. Okay, so it's complicated formula is because we have taken the potential from this book. We considered three spectra problem where we have taken capital H equal to 2, small h belonging to 1, 2, or 3, and we have take values 0, 1, 3, 4, 6, 7 from first spectrum, 0, 2, 3, 5, 6, 8, 9 from second, and 1, 2, 4, 5, 7, 8 from the third spectrum. So in total, we have taken 18 eigenvalues and recovered the potential. So here you can see the plot of the original potential, recovered potential using 12 eigenvalues and using 18 eigenvalues. And you can see that for 12, there is a very minor difference near zero and pi, but for 18 eigenvalues, okay, actually everything coincides. And if you see at the plot of absolute value of error, the situation improves to 30 eigenvalues used, and one can recover the potential with 10 decimal digits from only 30 eigenvalues, very small computational time. And for second example, we have considered another potential, and the Hochstadt-Liebermann inverse problem. So now we suppose that the potential is known on the half of the interval, and that one spectrum is given. For numerical experiment, we have taken 40 eigenvalues, and even more, we discarded two eigenvalues, number 10 and number 35. We haven't tried to recover this missed eigenvalues, nothing. We just take these values and solve the problem. And so here you can see that again, the potential was perfectly recovered on the second half with again like 9 or 10 decimal digits. Okay, so here you can see the absolute error only with some a bit worse precision at the endpoints, but with like 10 decimal digits in the middle, in the most part of the segment. So, to present the result, first of all, I would like to recall the a representation of solution with the use of a transmutational operator. So it is known that there is a continuous function k of two variables, such transmutational integral kernel, that the solutions phi and s have the following representations. They are images of cosine function and of sine rho x over rho function under the action of this Volterra type integral operator. All that we know about this integral kernel is that it is a solution of some Gursat problem and satisfies the following Gursat conditions when x equal to t or x equal to minus t. And what is important is that this integral kernel is independent on the spectral parameter. You can consult the book of Marchenko for the proof. Okay, so in the joint paper with Vladislav Kravchenko and Luis Navarro from 2017, we have proposed to look for the expansion of the integral kernel and for the expansion of its derivative in the form of Fourier-Legendre series, So with respect of the variable t, we have Legendre polynomials, and with respect to the variable x, okay, we have some coefficients depending on x. And what is in what we need from these representations actually is that the very first coefficient beta zero is sufficient to recover the potential. So the first coefficient is given by phi of zero x minus one over two. And from such representation, one can easily see that the potential q is equal to phi prime over phi at zero, or at the same time, it is two by the second derivative of beta zero over two beta zero plus one. So if you can find the first coefficient beta zero, it is sufficient to recover the potential. And at the same time, it is sufficient to recover the parameter h as well. Okay. How one can recover this parameter beta zero? And before that, I will need some another results. First of all, the solutions phi and s have the following representations. Known as Neumann series of Bessel functions. So you can see that they can be obtained just by substituting the series representation for the integral kernel and its derivative into the formulas I have shown you. But the solution phi is the sum of cosine function plus a sum involving the same coefficients beta multiplied by spherical Bessel functions. And the solution S has a very similar form. The derivatives involves the coefficients gamma. Okay. So now, to present one more result, consider the values of these coefficients gamma at the point pi, at the end point, and let us denote by Hn the linear combination of gamma n plus I h, capital H multiplied by beta n, and consider also the following parameter omega. It is a sum of small h, capital H, and one half of the average of potential, and omega 2, which is omega minus small h. In such case, the following representations hold for the characteristic determinants functions delta and delta 0. So delta, it is given by such expression. So it is some given function, okay, involving sine, cosine, and again a sum involving this coefficients hn multiplied by spherical Bessel functions. Delta 0, okay, something very similar. And also for the derivative with respect to rho, we have an explicit formula. So these formulas 27 and 28 are the starting points for us. And now we will see, but again, just a small information before. How one can find the coefficient beta zero. So the technique behind is that there is a well-known Gelfand-Levitan equation. So if one knows a spectrum of the first inverse problem and the corresponding Norman constants, then one can define such function f. And in such case, a function g, which is related to the integral kernel and have such series representation, is related with the function f by the following Gelfand-Levitan equation. And in the paper of Kravchenko and myself from 2021, we have proposed a direct method of recovering the potential based on such integral equation. So you can see that all that we need is to recover somehow the following spectral data: the numbers rho n, which are square roots of the eigenvalues, and the numbers alpha n. If we can recover these numbers, we are done. We have the algorithm. The only thing which I would like to add here is that actually we need to recover a large number of these numbers, a large quantity of these numbers for anything to work, like 1,000 numbers with nice accuracy. And later I will show you how that can be done. So it is not sufficient to have like 10 this numbers, 10 this numbers for everything to work. It is, okay, something can be done in such case, but if our method can recover at once like 1,000, it's much better. So now returning to the expression for Weyl function. Okay, please let me show you. For this equation 11, the Weyl function is given to the is equal to the fraction of two characteristic functions. Let us substitute here the series expressions for this function delta and delta zero, and multiply everything by delta. So we arrive to the following equation, that the Weyl function multiplied by delta plus delta zero should be equal to zero. So here we are substituting the series representations. rearrange the terms, and we arrive to the following equation. So here we have omega multiplied by the Weyl function by cosine, omega 2 multiplied by the sine of rho over rho, and and two infinite sums involving these parameters h2n, h2n plus 1, and involving Weyl function and spherical Bessel functions. And in the right-hand side, we have something, okay, fixed. So now suppose that we have the values of the Weyl function given in some infinite set of points. If you substitute these points to the equation 32, we obtain an infinite system of equations for infinite system of linear algebraic equations for the unknowns omega, omega 2, h2n, and h2n plus 1. So we have a system which is linear. And okay, of course it is infinite, but at least it's linear. And can we say something about its solution? We know that if original inverse problem is solvable, then the obtained infinite system will also be solvable. Moreover, I will show that its solution is unique in some sense. For that, I just need to introduce new unknowns. It's by some renormalization. And in such case, the sequence of numbers Cn is a sequence from L to small. So it is a sequence such that the sum of squares is finite. This is because these numbers are Fourier coefficients of such square integrable function with respect to the system of normalized Legendre polynomials. And we can rewrite the infinite linear system in the following form. K here runs through all the points rho k and through all the values m of k. Okay, rho tilde k here is the square root of the given number zeta k. So 34 is just a reformulation of the original infinite system of equation. It is, as you can see, a linear system. And we know already that such system possesses a solution belonging to L2 small. Now, the following result, which was established in our paper, states that if the original inverse problem is solvable and the points zeta k satisfy the Gestas-Zedel-Riou-Simon condition, then the infinite system 34 is uniquely solvable. It has a solution, and the solution is unique. But unique solution in the class of L2 small solutions. Okay. And from the practical point of view, such system, okay, we are never given the infinite number of points. So always we only have a finite set of pairs, zeta k and mk. And in such case, what can be done is that we consider the infinite system, we truncate it, and we arrive to the following truncated version. We solve it. Actually, it may be ill-posed, so in some cases we may look for less number of coefficients, h0, etc., than the number of points given. It's not a problem because these coefficients hn are rapidly decaying. So if you find less coefficients, it's not a problem. For many nice potentials, like from 10 to 20 coefficients HK are sufficient to recover the potential. The only problem with that system is that we don't have any result saying that, okay, it is solvable if its solution will converge to solution of the infinite system if we increase the number of points, etc., etc. By the moment, it's the only thing which we have. We have the result for infinite system, we take the truncated system, we solve it, and we obtain the potential. It is still an open problem to show that such truncation process is stable in some case. And now suppose that we have found all the coefficients. Omega, omega 2, and hn. What that means? That means that we can calculate the characteristic function delta of lambda for any value of lambda or of rho. So here I'm supposing that we have infinite number of coefficients. So now that means that if you can this characteristic function for any lambda for any value of rho, the recovery of eigenvalues reduces to finding zeros, real zeros of this function. And having the spectrum, the corresponding Norman constants can be calculated from this formula, for which I have shown you before that there is an explicit series representation for all terms involved. And if you have only a finite number of coefficients, then we can calculate an approximate characteristic function by such form. We can find its zeros. And a very nice property here is that the error of approximation of such a truncated form can be uniformly bounded with respect to rho on the whole real line. Meaning that from approximated characteristic function, we can find any set of approximate zeros with non-deteriorating accuracy, which is very nice because I was saying you that actually for the method to work, we need like 1,000 eigenvalues. Okay, no problem. We will have 1,000 eigenvalues with the same accuracy. And afterwards, having these eigenvalues, we have an explicit formula how to find the corresponding approximate Norman constants. So as you can see, here I'm presenting everything which is needed to formulate an algorithm of reduction of the inverse problem by Weyl function to the inverse problem by the spectral density function. By eigenvalues and corresponding Norman constants. And just to recall, after that, having all Z numbers at hand, the procedure is very simple. One just have to calculate some quantities and solve a linear system of equations. So here I am showing formulas which are not very complicated for some coefficients. Having these coefficients, one can form, we have the result that the coefficients beta m satisfy the following infinite system of linear equations. And as I was saying you, we are only interested in the coefficient beta zero. And we have already the result that truncating such system we have a stable process of solution, that, this, that it is stable with respect to some small errors and the coefficients, etc., etc. I can refer you to this paper to see more details. And what is interesting is that practically, like at most 10 equations are necessary in the truncated system to recover the coefficient beta zero with very nice accuracy. So it is a method which can be done very fast computationally. Okay, so having all of that at hand, we proposed the following algorithm of solution of the inverse problem. So given a finite set of values zeta n mn, we have to do the following to recover the potential and the parameters small h and capital H. First, we need to solve this system 35 and find the constants omega, omega 2, and h0, h, okay, here I'm saying k minus 2, minus 2. But as I was saying, that the number of coefficients can be less than the number of points given. We may look at the system as overdetermined system and apply least squares method to solve it. Okay, now second, having the numbers omega and omega 2, we immediately obtain parameter h. Now, the next step, from the coefficients h0, hm, we find approximate eigenvalues lambda k as the zeros of the approximate characteristic function, and we compute corresponding Norman constants. Now, if the first eigenvalue is non is different from zero, we need to perform the shift of eigenvalues. And for some set of points from the segment from zero to pi, we compute all z coefficients which I have mentioned before from this system. We solve this truncated system and find thus the coefficient beta zero. And we can compute the potential using such formula. It is 2 beta zero second derivative over 2 beta zero plus 1. And having the potential, the capital H can be recovered from omega 2 by such formula. So on this step, numerical differentiation works without any problem. And okay, that's all. We need to be able to solve the inverse problem. We have some set of values, we perform the steps, and we have the potential. And for smooth potentials, as I have shown you at the beginning, it works with just like 20 or 30 points zeta n, without any information if zeta n is eigenvalue of node. We don't have anything about the problem. We have just point and value of the Weyl function, and as an output we have the potential. Again, some example of the algorithm. Now we return back to the classical two spectra inverse problem, the same potential, and here I am presenting you the absolute error. So as you can see, the accuracy increases to some extent, stabilizes, but at least we can recover like 8 decimal digits having only 32 eigenvalues. When the potential is not smooth, the situation is not okay. So you can say, you can ask a question, and how the algorithm performs if you compare it with some special algorithm designed for solution of this two spectra inverse problem. For algorithm which knows that the numbers given are actually numbers corresponding to two spectra. Of course, such algorithm can work better because it has more information. And here I will show you that indeed it is the case. If you consider a potential which is discontinuous, the proposed method works, but not as good as the specially designed algorithm. So here we are using 201 eigenvalue pairs, and you can see that the potential has discontinuous derivatives here, has even some jumps here. Still, we were able to recover it up to Gibbs phenomena at the jump points. And you can see that the error is more or less fine. But if you look to the same problem recovered with the specially designed algorithm from our article of 2021, you can see that indeed the accuracy is better. So we have like at least one or two decimal digits more recovered by specially designed algorithm. But what I'm mentioned here is that here we don't have any information about potential or anything. So if you face some algorithm, if you face some inverse problem where there is no general, there is no special algorithm, we can apply this reconstruction based on the Weyl function because it may be very simple. You don't have to look for some asymptotics for distribution of eigenvalues, nothing. You just take the numbers and you, you have a result. And okay, one more algorithm, potential which is not that smooth. You can see that potential has continuous derivative from this formula, but the second derivative is discontinuous. And here we have three spectra inverse problem and 60 or 120 eigenvalues at, in total were used to recover the potential. It's quite good except for the endpoints where okay, a little bit more eigenvalues help to achieve better accuracy. And so here you can see the absolute error, like we are able to recover three decimal digits. Now to comment that not in any case our algorithm performs perfectly. There are some situations when it may fail or experience difficulties. One such example is the following. So now we consider the same nice potential, such boundary condition, and we consider 10 spectral problems. So we have H, which belongs to this set of numbers. And for each spectral problem, we take just the first eigenvalue. So we have 10 eigenvalues in general, but all belonging to the segment from 0 to 1, because they are the first eigenvalues of the problem. Very, very dense set. Theoretically, the problems of such type, if you have the infinite set of H and you take the first eigenvalue, it's a nice problem because your eigenvalues will have a finite accumulation point and you can recover the potential without a problem. But practically, it's not the case. You can see here that it's almost no similarity between the original potential and the recovered one. And even taking more values of H, the situation does not improve. The system is extremely ill-conditioned and one cannot do a lot in such case. But the situation improves a lot if we take at least three eigenvalues from each spectral problem. If you take lambda 0, lambda 1, and lambda 2, you can see that more or less we have recovered the potential. So another situation which was surprising for us is that for some set of points, okay, not for some set, but for this particular set of points, which are 1 over 4 plus n over 2 squared, the algorithm experienced some problems in recovering the potential. So the red line shows the absolute error for this set of points. The system was not singular. Everything was solved, but was far from the exact solution. And what is strange is that by taking a very small change of this set of points, okay, instead of 0.25, taking 0.249, and you can see that the algorithm was able to recover five more decimal digits. Or taking the same set of points and including 1.0, again, the algorithm was able to work perfectly. So some problem with that set of points is that it does not satisfy, if you think about that, continued it by the same formula to the to infinity. This set of points does not satisfy the condition of Gestasi del Rio Simon, and in some set it is the most distant from zeros and poles of the M function. I don't have another explanation why it doesn't why it's so bad, but it was like some phenomena. We have find a set which simply was bad. Evaluation of the set, the situation was improved. And just the last example, we don't need to take the real points. We have taken the points which were points in complex plane. We have made it a small step to the complex plane from the real line. And the algorithm also was able to recover the potential taking these points. If you go far from the real line to some complex sets, okay, in such case we experience singular system and the situation was not so nice, but at least some variations are not the problem for the algorithm. And that's all I was going to present, and I only want to finish my talk by two references. First one is the published paper where some of the information is presented, and the second is the preprint published in archive and containing all the details from this talk. Okay, thank you very much, and are there any questions?
Thank you, Sergei. There are questions.
Remarks, questions.
O preguntas. I'm not sure if I missed it, but you didn't mention what happens to the system when the Weyl function is equal to infinity.
Yes, I didn't mention this detail. Okay, I will show you. So the situation in such case is very simple. Okay. Let us look at this system. It separates to two systems. So if m is equal, there are two cases. If m is equal to infinity, we may simply say that this term disappears, this term disappears. We divide everything by m, and we left just with this term, and with this term. So we have only one half of the system to solve. The same happens if the Weyl function m is equal in some point to zero. In such case, we have this term, and this term left. So, like in two spectrum, in two spectra inverse problem, the system 32 separates into two separate systems.
And I'm not sure if it didn't provoke any confusion, but you used the notation HN for two things in the talk. One was here as the coefficients of, well, this combination of coefficients for the transmutation kernel, and another as boundary conditions for different Sturm-Liouville problems. When you consider the Sturm-Liouville problem by n spectra, but I suppose that there was no confusion. Okay, I think we have an interruption. Not sure where it is. If it's in the internet of Sergei or mine.
I think it was Sergei.
Sergei. But if you have questions, probably I can answer some of them. Well, Sergei is outside. So if not, then I think we can finish. Harit, please.
Your formulas are in general expressed in terms of the capital M. So if you change to the small m function, do you expect any changes in your absolute errors, for example, or things like that?
No, I think not.
Okay.
I think it's hello. Okay.
My internet design decided to take a break.
Yes, but it was fortunate that at the end of the talk, not earlier.
Yeah, right.
Okay, but according to the question, I understand you that HN are the coefficients, and HN appeared in some boundary conditions.
Yes, but I hope that there was no confusion.
Because it was like just explaining some relation where I was not speaking about the coefficients. It was like in two separate parts.
And Harit is asking if instead of M capital, we consider the M small. If we if we expect some change in the errors in computation, so on.
No, because as I was saying, it's equivalent.
But from the point of view of errors. You'll have the small m in the denominator in that case.
So that's true.
So you will have bigger errors. Yeah. Maybe that's why you work with capital M.
No, that's not. Another reason why we work with capital M is that a small m does not include the parameter small h. It only includes capital H.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
And so this.
But then this is interesting.
Yes, so we have some possibilities, like for problems involving only small m, we can formulate different problems involving capital M. We can take different value of this h equal to 0 or to 1, formulate different systems and solve it and compare the results. So we have like indeed different possibilities.
Okay. Okay.
It's interesting, but only some tests were done.
Also, why don't you compare in absolute errors also, why don't you compare with some Taylor series of the exponentials, those potentials you have, for example, Q1, you have an exponential there. So, because you truncate anyway. So maybe it's better to compare with some Taylor series of the potential.
Okay, Harald. Here I will say you to compare with the Taylor series, I need to have an algorithm which will give me the Taylor series. Okay. Mm-hmm. Because our algorithm recover the potential, and I don't utilize the coefficients, for example, HN here. I'm presenting the final representation for the potential. There was some work done but in previous papers to see how well an approximation can be done, etc. But the idea here is that if you try to recover the characteristic function delta using the Taylor series, from its zeros you can recover like, I don't know, 10 eigenvalues. And we can easily recover like 1,000 eigenvalues.
Okay, if so.
Yes, if you want to use the Gelfand-Levitan equation to obtain a good accuracy, you need a large number of eigenvalues. So, like a Taylor series will not help you in that. If you look for some method which will allow you to recover.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
If there are more questions. What we have in fact here, I think, well, it was implicit here, but it's present, is the following thing. Let us consider, for example, the following problem. Just you have some first eigenvalues, for example, from two spectra. Okay, some first eigenvalues from two spectra. Then applying this algorithm, which Sergei described, we can in fact obtain much more eigenvalues. What is not clear completely, so we compute the characteristic functions of the two Sturm-Liouville problems, and from this characteristic functions we find more eigenvalues. Okay, but in fact, if what is the potential to which they correspond? So this potential shouldn't be far away from the exact potential. Yes, but and in fact, we use this thing implicitly in the computations. So probably you could speak about this a little bit.
Okay. I have mentioned that according to such things like stability and everything, we are still, it's still like an open problem. That you are right. What we are doing here implicitly is like we have spectrum. Like we are doing interpolation for numerator and denominator of the Weyl function.
Mm-hmm.
Again, what we are doing here is like a problem of complex interpolation. We have a meromorphic function, and we are presenting its interpolation in, of some special form.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not an easy topic, and if you look for some results, the situation is very complicated. There are some works about such interpolation, but the person are asking that the meromorphic function will be given like in the wrong direction. Not like the spectrum of the problem, but to the negative axis. You have to be far away from zeros and poles for some theoretic results about interpolation to work. And here we are working with a different set of points, which is interesting from practical point of view. So in some case, it's like a first paper, like a proof of concept that it is worth to pay more attention to this problem, to try to look if it is possible to prove stability, if it is possible to show that, okay, maybe not the potential, but at least that the obtained coefficient beta zero is closer to the exact one, etc., etc. If we will take more points, that we have some convergency results, but it's a huge field, and it is still open.
Could you comment about the following? In the last example, when we add zero to the set of points, why this helps?
Okay, in some sense, please let me show. I was showing you this condition of Vestesi del Rio y Simon. So if you take a look at the series of points without zero, what we have here is that all the points here are given exactly, okay, I have to take the square, but in the numerator we will have like n, and in the numerator we will have n squared, so we will have the divergent series. By adding zero, we are obtaining the series which is convergent, so like it is a set of points. Zero like is making that, supposing that we have the infinite series given by the same formula, the infinite series satisfies such condition, but without the point zero, it does not. I think maybe something is going here, or going to the theorem from Horvath. Probably there the condition is that some system of exponentials is complete or not. I think that adding zero is making the system like complete, or maybe in some sense all that exponents are orthogonal to one, and for that system everything breaks.
Okay, thank you.
So it's a nice question to check, and even to check not this condition, but more the system of Horvat about the closet of exponents. If it results that all the exponents generated by the numbers, which are 1 over 4 plus n over 2 squared, are orthogonal, for example, to 1 or distant from 1, that is an explanation why it fails. It's like we have an orthogonal system of functions, but missing the first term. And we are making projection. Of course, we will lose something huge.
Okay. Thank you. There are other questions. Well, if not, then thank you very much again.
Thank you.
And please be aware of the announcements.
Okay, and also as organizers, we invite everyone also to participate. So if anyone wants to make a talk, we are open.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank
Have
you.
A good weekend.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Bye.
Welcome.
Bye, thank you.